Got it. Yeah, because I'm going to be referencing my notes. So if there's something in chat that I need to see, maybe just bring that to my attention.
I'll raise my hand or something like that.
Yeah. There you go. And I think I'm right at about 45 minutes. So
okay. All right.
We'll have time for Q&A.
Yeah, fairly participatory. Okay, very good. Well, break a leg.
Thank you.
I just invited Kevin in, but I don't see him. Whoever Kevin is. Maybe he got tired of waiting. That seems unlikely.
He said they don't want me in. Yes, we want you, Kevin.
Or wait. Oh, there. No, he's not there. Yeah. There's Chaz.
There's someone.
Hi, Chaz.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Very well. Thank you.
How'd your event go yesterday?
Oh, it was nice. There was maybe 20-ish people there or something. The hot dogs, we had deluxe hot dogs that were well received.
Oh, hot dogs are always yummy. I mean, right. I know they have a bad rep, but they are good.
We had jalapenos and tomatoes and onions and sauerkraut. So it was happy dogs is what she called them.
You had a hot dog bar, which is even better.
Yeah, basically. Kevin and Andrea, welcome. If you're able to be on video, it's great for everybody. But if you're not able to, that's understandable too. We'll have just a little bit of a open conversation here for a few minutes, and then I'll make a couple of loco announcements. We do have, I think we've got 17 registered and 7 said yes to our calendar invitation. So we'll see how many actually come into the room. I'll give it like 2 more minutes here. So any big news of the morning, any current events I haven't noticed?
Oh, not necessarily current events, but I had a thought. So, you had mentioned the one thing is canceled this month, and do we need to check the events, or do those generally come out in a newsletter, and, you know, how much notice is there for that, question. I guess, in theory, you know?
Yeah. The free things we held about every 6 weeks, and we promote them mostly in our, well, I guess not mostly. We have an external newsletter, and then we have an internal newsletter, and then we have just an events promotion newsletter kind of thing. So we have 3 things each month, as well as social media posts and stuff. But always our event page is kind of kept updated with what's coming up next. So, and I'll talk about that here in just a minute. I've got Julie.
All right, I jumped the gun.
All good. I appreciate the prompt. Good morning, so Julie.
Crazy story while everybody's rolling in that I met Kurt through the podcast and all of this. And then through the long, wild, crazy, small world, turned out I knew he was from my grandparents lived in Worthington, Minnesota. My parents grew up in Worthington, Minnesota. Kurt spent some time in Worthington, Minnesota. And then through that, we've now found that we have a mutual friend that lives that they, you know, they knew each other. They were friends. And yeah, like all this weird connection stuff's all coming through. And here it was all because I found a loco think tank ad in the lifestyle magazine.
Yeah, funny world sometimes, funny world sometimes. Welcome, Kevin. And Julie chatted me and said that she'll be on camera in a few minutes here. So I'm going to go ahead and just get us started, a couple minutes tardy. This is being recorded, and so we will send that out. Thanks for being here, those of you that here in person. I wanted to, I guess, firstly say we've got a couple of loco think tank things kind of on the radar right now. Next week, Thursday, so day after a week from now, we've got a Loco Social at the NoCo Hive Collective, which is the home office of Clean Bees, which is a maid service business. It's been a member of Loco for many years. Katie Straubel is the owner. And her space requires that she have a kind of a staff meeting room, but they only use it once a week for a morning. So they've got a co-working space that's available like all the time. It could be a event for anniversary parties or birthdays or things like that, or a board meeting or whatever. So come and join us for that. I think Loco's got the beverages, and Clean Bees has got the Hive Collective has got the food. So I'm expecting some tasty treats down there as well. So that's next Thursday. And then, our newest chapter is the Next Level 3 chapter with Kim O'Neill. She was podcast number 86, if you're a podcast fan. And so we've got a handful of seats, really, I guess, 6 seats still left in that chapter. And so really trying to fill that group out, because these groups work a lot better when they have, 7 to really, we like to have 10, 11, 12 members. So that is the biggest Loco updates on the radar. And since nobody else has trickled in, I will just get us started. I was introduced to Kathy Rushing about 2 months ago now, maybe in April, I think, and through a mutual friend, and was just really impressed with her insights and character, and we were mutual podcast fans, and so that was a grounding. She's new to Fort Collins, relatively moved here during COVID Nation, kind of, or right before, I forget, but so I said, well, hey, we can have more people hear your message and know what you've learned through years of helping couples. So Kathy, why don't you just take it over, and I'll be your host.
Thank you so much. And we might just have everybody mute their sound. If you have a question, hop in the chat and let Kurt know, and he'll wave his hand at me. There's also a link in the chat where you can download a PDF that has just a real basic format of what I'm covering today. Excuse me. Anyway, thank you, Kurt, so much for inviting me. And I really am just so excited to be meeting more people in this wonderful community. My background is 30 plus years as a marriage and family therapist. And I'm going to start with a story. It's a two-part story to give you a little bit of a glimpse of the journey that Mark and I have been on. In 1998, my husband Mark started an assisted living business called All's Care. We provided care for Alzheimer's and other dementia patients in a small home-like setting. This was several years into a second career as a nursing home administrator. We won't go into the first one that had led up to that, but there were other entrepreneurial ventures before this. He had been through several job transitions already as facilities he managed were bought up by larger companies that brought in their own team and said, thank you very much, we don't need you. And so when he made the decision in 98 to start this business, we honestly thought that starting our own business couldn't be any harder than looking for yet another job. Needless to say, we were a bit naive. About that same time, I started my own private marriage and family therapy practice. At the time, our kids were 15, 12, and 8. So it was a really busy time of life. And we were like, what were we thinking? Later, we asked that, not at the time. So then in 2012, about 14 years into the business, we got the news from our CPA that we owed, are you sitting down for this? $85,000 in taxes. We had built several new communities over those years, and there was a lot of startup cost. Accounting policies help level out the steep financial investments that are involved in opening new businesses, especially when real estate is involved. I had heard the term deferred losses, but didn't ask a lot of questions until that day when Mark gave me the dreaded news. And I was hit with the reality that deferred losses translated to ginormous tax bill. How in the world were we going to pay this off? It was just a sinking feeling. Right on the heels of that bombshell, I got the news that there had been a fire in my mom's home. She lived about 3.5 hours away. And we had suspected for a little while that there was something going on in her mind. And though I had set up several appointments to try to get her in for an evaluation, every time I went to pick her up, she refused. So here we were dealing with this, and that fire pushed her fragile brain just right over the edge. And as the oldest daughter and one of three girls, the one with the power of attorney, I began the process of trying to move her and make decisions about her care as she fought me tooth and nail. So we were pretty much running on empty, which is never a good place for a marriage. Mark had likened the stress of growing the business to pushing a ginormous ball, trying to get it to just go one revolution and pick up momentum. He had become kind of irritable, not the man that I had known for 30 years. One day I came into the kitchen with a question about something probably financial because I did all the books, tried to keep the bills paid. And Mark's response, which I don't even remember his exact words now, put me on the defensive. And I said, you know what? Maybe we need to take a break from each other. That was not what I planned to say that day, but all the stress of the months and even years prior to that came crashing down that day. And when I said that, Mark just slid to the floor and wept. I've never seen my strong husband so broken. And I'm not a hard heart. So I came around the island, sat down beside him, put my arms around him. And we sat there for, I don't even know how long. If somebody had walked into the room, they might have thought someone had died. There was so much grief just pouring out. And just tears washing away years of stress and frustration that had taken a toll on both of us. Well, the very next day, Mark had visited, he visited a C12 board that he had signed up for. Now, C12 is a Christian-based peer board for entrepreneurs and business owners. Part of what they cover every month in that meeting is a balance wheel that they review, and that taps into kind of, you know, all the elements that go into a balanced life, your emotional, relational, spiritual, recreational health. And Mark shared very vulnerably just how broken we felt at that point. And he was met with the most kind validation and acceptance. And he finally felt like no longer was he going to carry this load that he'd been carrying for so long. And when he came home that night, I felt like for the first time, I had my husband back. Well, that began a focused time of working hard on our marriage. We had always tried to prioritize our marriage, but we didn't realize the toll that business had taken. We began to experience an even deeper connection as we got on the same side of the line. And thankfully, I had a lot of tools I had acquired as I worked with other couples. But we didn't find resources that address some of the unique challenges of our marriage as business owners and entrepreneurs. Were we the only ones struggling with the ups and downs of growing a business, trying to keep the never-ending challenges of personnel, sales, investors, customers contained so we could have a life? Sometimes we felt very alone in that. So I decided to create resources that we couldn't find. And what I'm sharing today is a tool that I hope will provide a way for you and your partner to stay connected and grow deeper in your relationship while building a business. Now, the second part of this story, I'll keep very brief, but it's where we are currently. That same business did not survive the pandemic. Months of shutdown, increased wages, and a general fear of admitting their loved ones kept people kind of from admitting, and our census just stayed stagnant through 2021. We finally had to make the gut-wrenching decision to pull the plug. We closed one building, sold off the others, paid off investors, and we were done on a business that should have survived long after we were gone. We bought a porta potty business here 2 years ago and another business last year in Craig. We're rebuilding, and it's not an easy time. But we know this for sure. We are in this together, and we will survive regardless of what happens to the businesses. Now, that's a lot, and I don't want you to think it's all bad news when it comes to the intersection of marriage and business. But I want you to know that when I say I understand the pressure of owning a business, I'm not kidding. I came up with the acronym of THRIVE to capture foundational principles that you can come back to over and over until they're somewhat second nature. Some of the tools may feel a little awkward at first, but learning something new never feels comfortable right away. We practice and we learn. Using these tools regularly will demonstrate the essence of the word thrive. The definition, according to Merriam-Webster, is to progress toward or realize a goal despite or because of circumstances. Let me say that again. Thrive, and we're talking about in your marriage, means to progress or realize a goal despite or because of circumstances. Now, I want you to know that in this, when we talk about marriage, I am referencing any committed relationship as you define it. It's just easier to say marriage instead of a whole list of other options. But so tell me, what does thriving in your marriage look like? On that handout, if you had a chance to download it, and if not, just take a piece of paper. And I want you to take a moment and think about three things you want to be true in your relationship, even if they aren't true at the moment. For instance, maybe it's, I want to be able to tell my partner my fears and worries and feel supported. Or I want our relationship to be a safe place for both of us to risk making mistakes and know that we have each other's backs. Okay, take a minute and just reflect on that, if you will. Okay, the ones I can see look finished, so we'll jump in. You know, when you're in the midst of building a business, it can feel like there's no time for anything else. And I think that's why a lot of times our relationships kind of fall off the radar a little bit. The Thrive framework takes a lot of resources and puts them into a practice that you can begin to use today. So are you ready? Let's get started. First of all, the letter T incorporates two principles. The first is tell your spouse how you appreciate them. Now, this goes for both partners. It's very common for spouses to be involved in a startup, not always because they want to be. Sometimes it's the reality of long or odd hours that the entrepreneur literally isn't home to help with the kids or mow the yard or help with meals. Verbalizing that you appreciate the pieces they pick up is a big deposit in the love bank. Even when you have negotiated tasks at home, maybe take a minute, look them in the eye and say, I really appreciate you taking on the extra load while maybe I'm traveling this week. I couldn't do it without you. Say whatever feels natural, but make sure to look in their eyes and make it intentional, not just a passing, hey, thanks, you know. And this is one of, you know, for my action takers, this is something you can do tonight, right? Is maybe you do already appreciate, but maybe you haven't just verbalized that to your partner. On the flip side, and I'm trusting that you'll share this framework with your partner, it's so powerful to acknowledge your work as an entrepreneur. You may appear strong and fearless, but deep inside, are you aware of that little nagging voice that says, wow, they really think I know what I'm doing? If they only knew how much I question myself sometimes. Our words are important, and words of encouragement and gratitude are never wasted. There was a time, a couple of years into starting All's Care, that because we both worked in town, Mark and I could slip away for lunch while the kids were at school. And there was a day we were at our favorite lunch place and really just chatting. I had no intention of like telling him what I was about to tell him. And I just said offhand, I said, you know, I am so proud of what you have started. I mean, look at the communities, look at the people we're taking care of. And you started that from nothing. And that's about all I said. And I looked over and one single salty tear, as we say, that's from some movie. And I was like, oh my gosh, are you okay? And he was like, you have no idea how much that means to me. And I didn't, I really did not know how much he was struggling with self-confidence. And just those words were very affirming to him. The second T stands for team us. In a committed relationship, there is you and there is me and there is us. If you think of like two circles, me and you, think of a bigger circle that surrounds both of those. It's like a third entity called us. And in long-term relationships, this really does become kind of a third entity to consider in a relationship. Learning to think of this entity when making decisions leads to questions like, is this the best thing for us? Sometimes the answers don't come easily and you have to process it with healthy dialogue. Or maybe you put off something that you really want to do, but as you and your partner talk about it, it is not the best time or the best thing for us, maybe right now, maybe later. But just keeping that perspective really can shift conversations at times. Okay, our second letter in the acronym is H, and this stands for healthy communication and conflict skills. This encompasses much more than we can cover in this webinar, but learning healthy communication is a process. No one is born knowing how to negotiate or ask for what we want and need. Many people make the mistake that believing that if we love each other, it'll just, you know, things will work themselves out. Well, newsflash, they don't. Great relationships happen when couples are intentional about learning how to communicate better. And this is the sort of thing that I help couples learn and apply and develop over time. Also, conflict is inevitable in a long-term relationship. Sometimes people get very worried and think we're fighting, there's something wrong. Well, maybe, but the reality is every couple has disagreements. Most conflict, and this is important to remember, most conflict is never resolved, it's managed. So we learn to appreciate the way you and your partner are wired, and that goes a long way in diffusing conflict. We learn to accept our differences as part of what makes us unique instead of trying to change the other person. Let's say you and your partner are planning a weekend getaway. You like to plan every detail. You want to know where you're going to eat and every activity. But your partner, they love to be spontaneous. And so, you know, they want to get there and see what's around and let's find a place to eat just on a whim. Obviously, two very different perspectives. So how do you negotiate that? Is one right and the other wrong? I would say no, it's just different. And so you have to learn to manage that. And so the more that you learn about your own personality and the wiring of your partner, the more you can learn to appreciate, negotiate, and it really becomes an art that we practice over a lifetime together. It has troubled me a little bit in recent years about how polarized our country has become, and that has filtered right down to our families. I had a woman ask in a webinar a while back, she said that her husband was not woke enough, and that she just could not continue the relationship if he didn't change immediately. Well, that is kind of troubling because ultimatums are not a healthy approach to relationship differences. People can change over time, but the essence of who you are is not going to change. I think it's helpful to remember the words of Mother Teresa, who said, if we truly want peace in the world, let us begin by loving one another and our families. So here's something you can triggers it, or maybe it's an argument that has been on repeat for years, and every couple tends to have those. So you're familiar with that kind of the dance, and we learn, you know, one steps this way and the other steps in response. But it's a phrase that I love to keep in my back pocket, and it's help me understand more about why you feel this way, or how you came to believe XYZ. But just those words, help me understand, gives your partner a chance to explain their perspective. But the important thing is to be ready to listen. And I mean, really listen, not just like I'm biding my time and forming my response, but really listen to what they're saying. And you don't have to agree with what they're saying, but you can validate it. And validation sounds something like, well, I can see how you might feel anxious about going on vacation with my family. Let's talk about some options. And doesn't that sound very different than, why do you always have to be such a jerk when we're trying to make plans with my family? Another tool I love to share with couples is that of getting on the same side of the line. When we stand on opposite sides and try to convince the other to see things my way, conflict becomes entrenched and no one wins. We just, you know, are doing this. Instead, think of drawing an imaginary line and you both get on the same side of the line. I think when Mark and I started doing this, we literally like took out a piece of paper one day, drew a line. And then with both of you on the same side of the line, you name the problem. Yeah, give it a name. And then you can begin to problem solve together. Sometimes, you know, there are decisions that you or your partner make that have an impact on the other person. And it's important to be able to take your ownership in that and take responsibility for the consequences of your choices or actions. But there are many arguments that can be diffused when you stop trying to place blame. So let's say, for instance, you've both had a long day, no one planned dinner, and you lob grenades back and forth. Well, I thought you said you were going to make tacos tonight. No, you said you were going to warm up leftovers, whatever. Instead, you name the problem. We need to eat. So you figure out how to eat and, you know, figure out together, okay, how are we going to resolve this? I mean, that's a small thing, right? But it's good also to start with small things, not big issues when you're learning some of these tools. So maybe once you're not hangry, you can back up and say, what are we going to do to get a better schedule for who is making dinner? Or maybe we start ordering prepped meals. I don't know. Again, there's no right or wrong. It's how you manage, right? There are books and seminars and all kinds of resources for learning healthy communication and conflict, or you can work with someone to help diffuse topics that may have become too sensitive to touch. But it is worth the time to learn healthy processes because guess what? How you handle conflict with your spouse is often how you handle it with employees, investors, and other important relationships in your life. Having a healthy marriage carries over into other relationships. A toxic relationship at home cannot help but influence work. So it is worth your time to pursue that. I just want to stop. Are there any questions or anything, Kurt? Anything I need to be aware of? We're doing good?
Some questions. Oops.
There you
I said nothing new, but I think we could okay. invite some questions if we wanted to.
Yes. Does anybody have any questions up to this point?
I thought one thing that I smiled at early on was Jill and I have called ourselves Team Bear since
love it.
The day after our wedding or something like that.
I love it. That really is so key. All right. Well, moving along, we get to R. And R stands for rhythms and rituals that maintain a healthy connection. Rhythms and rituals are the threads that create and deepen connections over time. I don't know if any of you saw the movie Otto. Oh, Kurt stepped away. He's going to play my clip here in a minute. are you there, Kurt? I lost him. There you are. Kurt, can you play that clip, please?
Yes, I sure will. Sorry, I went
too. Thank you. That's okay.
There it is. And I'm here. And I think this should work. Optimize video. Okay.
Can you guys see this? Okay, there's a spot right there. Pull up, parallel, and back the car up until that bumper is in line with your side view mirror. Now straighten out, sir. Back up all the way to the curb. A little bit. Stop. Neutral. Brake. Key.
Is that it?
That's it. And we're right on time. These are semlors. Swedish eclairs.
Oh.
A little messy. But let's try. Yes. With your finger.
How did you find this place?
This was Sonia's place. I used to come here every Saturday at 1.
And then what?
Go home at 2. I'd wash and wax a car, and she would grade her papers and cook and spend the rest of the day reading.
What kind of books?
Her books. I tried to read some of them, but I'm not into books. Our friend said that we were like night and day. My life was black and white before I met Sonia. She was the color.
I would have liked her.
She was a force of nature. She convinced the school to start up a special program for the kids that needed
extra help. That's good, Kurt. We can't cut it there. A lot of kids had
problems at home or social anxieties.
I think we're back.
Did any of you happen to see that movie? Oh my goodness. It was such a sweet movie. This is just an example of how the rhythm that Otto and his wife shared for years still brought a very tender place for him after she was gone. The rhythms are, they're some of the daily and weekly things that remind us of how we value each other. Regular date nights become a time to focus on us. It's a time to talk about things usually other than business or the kids, or to just have fun. It might be Monday muffins, where you go to your favorite coffee shop and talk about the week ahead, or an intentional kiss when you come home, looking the other in the eye and saying, "How was your day? I want to hear about it." Rituals, they're not voodoo. They are the patterns that create a sense of home, belonging, predictability. Creating your own rituals to celebrate birthdays or anniversaries or holidays is important, especially in the early days of marriage. Maybe you keep pieces of how your family celebrated birthdays, but you add a twist to make it unique for you and your partner. And this is one way that a couple honors their family of origin while establishing a separate partnership. Planning a little getaway together for your anniversary can be a ritual that creates anticipation. And I'm just going to say anticipation is necessary for romance. So that's all a good thing. All right, the next letter is I, and this is inform and involve your spouse in business developments and decisions. Sometimes people ask me, because I have a podcast about entrepreneur marriage, and people will say, well, what is an entrepreneur marriage? And to myself, I think, well, if you know, you know, and if you don't, you don't. But my answer is something along the lines of, well, if one person in the relationship is an entrepreneur, then it impacts the whole family and marriage. If both people are entrepreneurs, heaven help them. Family finances are a prime example of how entrepreneur marriages are different than most other partnerships. There is a lot riding on the success of this venture. Finances are a difficult topic in any marriage, but a startup or growing business's up and down nature can add fuel to the fire. Regularly discussing expectations, challenges, and progress are essential to keeping your spouse informed. It requires good communication skills. See up above. The need for good communication skills is essential when discussing, especially expectations. You've got to make sure you're on the same page. Keeping your partner informed about the progress as well as the challenges you're facing minimizes the risk of any surprises. I mean, no one likes to hear that sales are down or that the investor you've been courting for months decided not to invest, but sticking your head in the sand doesn't change the reality. Meg Cadu, I think that's how you pronounce her name. Meg Cadu Hirschberg is married to Gary Hirschberg, the founder of Stonyfield Farms. Maybe you're familiar with their wonderful organic yogurt. For several years, she wrote a column for Inc. called Balancing Act about the impact of entrepreneurial business on families. After interviewing over 200 other entrepreneur couples, she then wrote a book called For Better or For Work. One of the things that she cautions other entrepreneur couples is to be aware of the added divorce risk related to the financial liability that entrepreneurs take on. She says, and I quote, "The busted up unions of business builders reflect all the usual suspects in divorce: financial strain, neglect, lack of communication, divergent goals. But other professions don't produce the toxic cocktail of resentment and anxiety created by putting the family's security constantly at risk." I don't know if that resonates with any of you, but you know, that has certainly been a lot of our journey, is that, you know, we're in this together because that's our future. Enjoying the rewards of a successful business is wonderful and sometimes enviable, As our business grew and Mark brought in people to help run the business, we had more time to travel and get to Colorado. We lived in Texas for a very long time, but our dream place was Colorado. And so we would travel here quite often. And people, I think, assumed we were retired, and we would say no. And they were like, well, I mean, literally, if I had a dollar for every person that said, well, must be nice. And we would just, you know, think to ourselves, well, you know, those people have no idea the sleepless nights or the times Mark had skipped a paycheck so that everybody else could get paid, right? But this is definitely one of the areas that I think is unique to an entrepreneur marriage, is just that financial risk that's at stake. But what if your spouse doesn't want to know anything about the business? This might be an indication that you didn't have their support from the beginning, and you might need some help navigating that. There was a study I found a while back in New Zealand that looked at the role of spousal expectations for male and female entrepreneurs. In other words, what were their expectations when they considered starting a business? And here's what they found, and this I'm quoting. What they found was that women and men tend to have different expectations of their spouse when contemplating starting a business. A woman looks to her husband for business advice, support, and encouragement, and considers the effects that starting a business may have on him or her, on his or her spouse. A man tends to assume support is forthcoming, and some men start businesses without explicit spousal support. Have an example of that. When Mark was on that C12 board, that one of his peers brought up every month that he and his wife were really struggling in their marriage. They tried to get some counseling, but they ended up divorcing. And sometime later, he agreed to sit down with Mark and me to discuss what happened. Now, we only have his side of the story, but from his perspective, he felt very alone in the business that he started. His wife never wanted details, just tell me when money's going in the bank. He said that later, a successful entrepreneur shared his advice with him. He said, the support of your spouse might be the greatest predictor of your success as an entrepreneur. If your spouse is in enthusiastic agreement with the decision to start or buy a business or start a venture, and you do your part to appreciate them, keep them informed, bring them into the vision process, you will not have a bigger cheerleader. And when the going gets rough, this is the person that will remind you of all the good things you've done, that hopefully it's a dip and not a cul-de-sac, as Seth Godin says. It can be really lonely growing your business, but the one by your side will make that journey worthwhile. All right, the next component is vision. One of the key elements of successful businesses is clear vision. Where are you going? How do you plan to get there? How long do you think it will take? What resources do you need? Now, every journey has unexpected elements. My goodness, we have all lived through a pandemic that no one planned as part of their vision process. Right? You heard our story. There were many others that didn't make it. Others were able to pivot or just hang on long enough. But I would venture to say that no one was unaffected by it. Creating a vision together will include the business vision. It's one way to involve your partner, but it's also important to include the whole person and both people in the vision you create as a couple. Whole person goals involve our physical, spiritual, social, family, community values. Both partners have desires and goals, and there will be some negotiation involved to make sure that no one feels they're getting the short end of the stick. I want to add here that it's super important that you be able to ask for what you need. Over the years, a lot of women that I've worked with seem to have a hard time asking for what they need. They are great at taking care of everyone else, but when it comes to their own needs, they tend to put off filling their own cup. And that can lead to bitterness or burnout. So if that resonates with you, I invite you to get curious about your ability to know what you need and ask for it. I find it helpful to review those goals and vision quarterly, just as you do in your business. Things change, and by having a regular pattern, it lets you stay on top of any shift you might need to make. A lot of times it doesn't have to be a super long process. Maybe you touch base on some things during a date night. Or maybe something significant has changed, the health of a parent, birth of a child, an adoption. And these change the family dynamics. Those would be triggers to review immediately, as the impact, of course, is felt right away. Many couples find it helpful to set aside a little more time, maybe a day, once a year, to review, celebrate, and recalibrate for the coming year. It doesn't have to be New Year's. It could be an annual anniversary review or whatever date works for you. And maybe this is just my bias because I love to celebrate, but I think it's important to celebrate steps along the way. You know, maybe that goal is very, very far away, that summit, but you can celebrate little things that are getting you there. And that helps you when it feels like a slog in that middle time. The last piece that I want to cover is E, stands for energy. You want to fuel it, protect it, pay attention to it. Entrepreneurs are driven to succeed. It's not uncommon for the early stages of a venture to require long hours, but this isn't sustainable. Just last week, I read an article about Elon Musk, who works 80 hours a week sometimes, sleeping on the floor of his office. And that is just it's not healthy for him, and it's not healthy for his family, who, by the way, he's been married 3 times, 10 children with 3 different, maybe 4 different. I think it noted there were some twins that were a secret, now not a secret. Anyway, we can look to him for a lot of things, but I think how he manages his family life might not be one of them. Entrepreneurs tend to be problem solvers, optimistic, self-starters, and passionate about their projects. But there is also a dark side that rarely gets discussed. Some early research by Dr. Michael Freeman, who is a psychiatrist and psychologist, suggests that entrepreneurs have a higher incidence of depression, anxiety, ADHD, drug abuse, and other mental health issues. No one functions well when they are exhausted or not eating for health. The stress of a startup or rapidly growing business can create a tipping point for some people. Learning to pay attention to your energy and making healthy choices for a balanced life is a good way to pay attention to your mental health before you fall into a dark hole. Some entrepreneurs have found that minimizing choices is the option they choose. Steve Jobs was known for his never-changing wardrobe, black mock turtleneck, blue jeans, New Balance sneakers. He never had to think about what he was going to wear. The fewer decisions that have to be made, the better is how some people view it. But that also leads to kind of a rut, maybe with eating the same thing every day and not looking at a more balanced nutritional diet. So by stepping back and again, looking at the whole person, you can be more proactive in protecting your energy. I've talked with many entrepreneur couples where the spouse is the one that had concerns about their partner's mental health first. They'd become irritable or weren't sleeping, and they weren't really connecting the dots as to what might be causing that. A supportive spouse can gently bring these observations to their entrepreneur partner. Get on the same side of the line, name it, you know, naming it might be, gosh, it seems you've been really irritable lately and it's not like you. What's going on? And so it takes it away from being a personal attack. Because you don't want to get to the point we were at in the story that I began with, where we both just crumbled. We had nothing left to give. So maintaining a healthy diet, sleep, and exercise routine is a starting place for the equilibrium amidst a busy schedule. human body simply isn't designed to keep pushing all the time. All right, well, that wraps up our overview of Thrive. And so let's review real quickly. You want to tell your partner you appreciate them, practice gratitude, and recognize Team Us. You want to have healthy communication and conflict tools. Develop rhythms and rituals that connect. You want to inform and involve your spouse in business decisions and progress. Vision, personal, joint and family, and business. And you want to pay attention to energy. You want to protect it. Now tell me, which area will you begin to focus on with your partner? Maybe this takes you back to the statement you wrote at the beginning of this presentation. And I, of course, encourage you to share this framework with them and get feedback about how you're doing in this different area. So maybe it begins a conversation about, you know, taking one. And what I like is there are six elements. So you can take one a month and just focus on one of those a month. Like maybe it's appreciation. And then you take another one the next month. And then guess what? 6 months, you can do it again. And you've spent a year. Didn't take a lot of time. You had some real specific guidelines or maybe something that leads you into, you know, looking for more resources. I just want to say I wish you and your partner all the best. I do offer a free 30-minute discovery call if you're interested in following up or if you have questions that have come up during this. My website is in transition. And so if you have any trouble reaching me, please just email me. There is the email is on that handout. And with that, it has been a wonderful privilege speaking with you today. And I want to open it up for any questions you may have.
Well, thank you, first of all. Appreciate the insights. I had a question of on the vision, especially like how do you differentiate vision and goals and how do you kind of set the structure of that? I think that's one place where my wife and I tend to kind of struggle. We enjoy the days and the years go by a little bit sometimes.
Yeah, things do go by quickly. Well, I look at vision as the long look, which, you know, they say that part of a healthy relationship is taking the long look. We can't get lost in the minutiae of today. But as we know in business, you have a vision of where you want that business to be maybe in 10 years. I don't know if any of you are familiar with EOS, but it has become hugely popular and a wonderful system for business. And I think kind of mirroring that in our relationships, but having a vision that is pretty far out. But then you break it down and you back it down into, okay, what are the things this quarter? What are the things this month? What are the things this week that get us there? And I think it also helps us to not get sidelined when things get rocky. You know, I think too often couples lose sight of that long term. You know, we want to be old and rocking on the porch together. And so, are we going to lose our minds because somebody didn't make dinner tonight? You know, does that help, Kurt? Yeah.
We've got several minutes left here yet. So other ponderances for Kathy?
And it doesn't have to be a question. I'm curious if this resonates with any of you in terms of like, have you ever felt different than some of your friends? Like you're struggling with things or you're challenged by things, and challenges can be a good thing, right? Mark and I laugh and say, we are basically unemployable. Like, could I go get a job somewhere? Probably, but I'm really unemployable and have been for most of my life. I'm not happy working for someone else because I have better ideas, I think. And so yeah, I'm just curious, maybe a raise of hands or just, you know, does this resonate? Julie, thanks. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Kathy. And I was often on camera, but this really resonates for me. My husband and I both have businesses and I started about seven years ago, full-time. And he started about 3 years ago, full-time. And we just had this conversation the other day, and it's when you were talking about, you know, kind of having that energy and having rituals and routines, or we've been walking because both of us have had injuries that we're recovering from. Anyway, so our conversation was about how he does things one way and how I do things another way. He's an engineer. I am very much a creative, a creator, that kind of thing. And so, you know, it just was like, we had this conversation that neither one of us is wrong and neither one of us is right. It's just different and we complement each other well. So I think even having that awareness of noticing it and then verbalizing it, you know, is important. So yeah, thank you for that.
Yeah, one of the things I didn't go in depth here, but it's also another service that I offer is doing the DISC profile, which I don't know if any of you have done different personality. There are many different profiles. And if they're valid profiles, you get a lot of the same, or things will sound similar. It's like this assessment might call it something different, but it's the same component, if you will. When our business started growing and Mark asked me at some point, he said, are there some assessments that we could use to help with our hiring and onboarding process? And I did some research and got certified in DISC and several other profiles offered through TTI that's based in Phoenix. Well, in learning to give the DISC, of course, I gave it to him. And it truly was an aha moment for him, because his whole life, he felt like there was something wrong with him because he just couldn't, you know, find a career path and just, you know, work his way up the ladder like everyone else that he knew did. Or like his dad was in ministry and Mark started off that way, but it was not, that's not really where his gifting was. And so it was a huge aha moment for him to realize that he was wired a certain way. And that's not to say, I think sometimes people think, well, I'm just this way, and so get over it, you know. But understanding your wiring can be very freeing when you understand, as he did, like, I am wired to start things and improve things. And it was like his confidence level just went up like crazy. And so that's just one example of understanding how we're different. And so, you know, even though I mean, I'm sure I've been guilty at times of saying, can't you just get a job? J-O-B. Yes, Kurt.
I was just remembering, I think, Chaz, is your husband an engineer also, and you're a creative? So I thought I saw a glimmer.
Yang. Yeah. People say, do you marry someone like you, or do opposites attract? And I find both are true. I mean, oftentimes people have, you know, left brain, right brain. But then there are ways that, you know, our values are aligned, for instance, and we're more similar.
Yeah. So Chaz just bounced. She has another meeting starting right now.
Sure. And
we have a custom of not running people over time. And so I just want to say, Kathy, thank you for these reminders. I think having, you know, even that printout and talking about it once a month with your special someone is probably a worthwhile endeavor. And you can email Kathy with her contact information there if you want to learn anything more. So thanks again, Kathy, Julie, Andrea, Kevin, thanks for being here, staying the whole time. And
thank you so much for having me. It's really been my pleasure. I hope to meet some of you in person soon.
All right, Godspeed.